Merci à toutes et...
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I would also like to thank those who were not able to participate in our first session this morning, our closed session. Recently, we held a press conference with our Secretary General. The Secretary General was very interested in coming together in, at this summit as a ministerial session, and we reached some unanimous decision, which I think is notable, and also thanks to the preparation. So we unanimously approved the declaration and all delegations prepared it very well. Now we would like to continue with our work and we would like to intensify the exchange of experience and knowledge in the future. This first declaration is a declaration on the 2014 summit, on the topic of the 2014 summit, the individual delegations also approved of this declaration for their own purposes, for the purpose of presenting it in their own countries and in the ever-changing circumstances in their countries. We also agreed on a new strategic funding framework, which is also remarkable. And in the forum, we also approved several documents that we will present shortly. When it comes to the declaration, it is supposed to be a guideline and it is supposed to be an inspiration for all stakeholders in transport, be it public authorities or private companies. Everybody should understand that we need a common policy strategy for transport in the future. Now I would like to give you the opportunity to take the floor to participate in the discussion. But first of all, I would like to give the floor to our Secretary General, José Villegas, and to give him the opportunity to welcome you all. After him, Pat Cox will have the floor, who also had the opportunity to speak to us today.
Not only the French presidency for all the leadership that has provided us in preparing for this very important ministerial council, but also the council itself for the demonstration of trust that it has transmitted to us by having these unanimous votes that create in the Secretariat a reinforced energy and commitment to continue at your service with the best possible evidence-based knowledge. We are happy to see so many ministers and leaders of industry here in the room. That's also a very good signal. The topic of today's session is the transport transformation, the innovations that are changing transport, and how this policy needs to respond. This is a clear reflection of how we understand the challenges that we're facing, but also the opportunities that our transport systems will have to once more help change the world. Not just react, but drive the change. We need innovative policies, we need strong leaders, we need a cohesive approach, and all of that we think the ITF is able and willing to support. We are very fortunate to be able to draw on the perspectives of three distinguished industry leaders today. And so let me thank you, Mr. Persson, Mr. Misteller, and Mr. Bertling, for your presence and for your willingness to share your experience and reflect with the ministers and the summer participants on how to formulate and tackle this challenge. So I look forward to this discussion and thank you all again for your participation. Monsieur le Président.
Merci. Je pense que nous pouvons...
Thank you very much. I think we can now begin with the second part of our session. Pat, the floor is yours.
Ministers, international institutions, you are very welcome to this open ministerial session. We have a busy agenda, so I will be very brief in introducing and setting a few ground rules. In respect of the running order, I will introduce and invite to the lectern our three guest CEOs. They will make a brief presentation, followed by a spontaneous question and answer session running for about 10 minutes or so, and then consecutively working through each of the presentations in this way. Could I say to the ministers who are present, if you wish to speak, could you please indicate by placing your card, which has your flag, so place your flag on its side. The Secretariat will take note and will make sure that I get to call you in response to your request. However, it may be in the course of the conversation, following the presentations, or following an intervention by a fellow minister, that you would like to make a spontaneous intervention to pick up a specific point. If you wish to make a spontaneous intervention, please just wave your card so we get to see you and call you up. Those are, I think, the basic ground rules. Self-evidently, I should add that we will need, in terms of the scale of our ambition this morning, to stick to pretty tight speaking times. But my experience here at ITF is that the ministers have always been extremely good at respecting that perspective. It is now my great pleasure to invite the first of our presentations today. That will be made by the Chief Executive Officer of Volvo, and invite Mr. Olaf Persson, please, to address us.
Thank you very much, and dear President, dear Ministers, Secretary General, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you again for giving me the opportunity to address some of the issues that are important for the transportation industry and for the Volvo Group. Volvo Group is one of the largest manufacturers of trucks, and we are proud owners of a number of famous brands around the world. Volvo trucks, of course, but also Renault truck in France, UD truck in Japan, and Mack truck in North America. We do have also a big operation in buses. We are one of the largest bus manufacturers in the world, and we also have activities within industrial engine and marine engines. We are around 110,000 employees, and we are active in 190 countries around the world. And we have 60 production sites in 30 countries. The Volvo Group's vision is to become the world leader in sustainable transport solutions. And by sustainable transport solution and the definition of sustainability, we revert back to the UN definition of sustainability. And that means that we look at sustainability not only from an environmental point of view, but also from an economic and social sustainability point of view. Traditionally, in the transport industry, the environmental sustainability has been in the forefront. And it is naturally extremely important that we always address environmental issues. But I think it's also very important that we, in talking about the transportation industry, broaden our focus also to talk about social and economic sustainability. We in the Volvo Group has had a long tradition in pioneering innovations within safety and environmental care. And I am absolutely convinced that innovations and new solutions to the transport sector can be a or the catalyst for all the three dimensions of sustainability. But in order for this to happen, we have to work really close between policymakers and the industry. I appreciate very much the ITF's intention to work closer with the industry, and we do appreciate very much and are happy to recently have joined the Corporate Partnership Board. So today I would like to talk about how we, the Volvo Group, as one of the industry leaders, can collaborate with you as policymakers to make sure that innovations and new solutions are used to increase traffic safety and reduce the negative environmental impact of the transport sector. Several of the global challenges that the world faces today are directly or indirectly related to the infrastructure and the transport sector. They include well-known challenges like climate change, population growth, urbanization, and shortage of natural resources and raw materials. And all of us here today, I believe, have a joint mission to facilitate and support the needs that we have of growing global trade, mobility, and welfare by increasing transport and resource efficiency. That's the key word. In order to meet those challenges, it is absolutely crucial to use existing transport systems in the most efficient way. Mobility is an important enabler for growth and welfare. Without it, societies as we know them today would not function. We all take for granted that we walk into a store today, we can buy fresh milk. But very few people understand and appreciate the enormous logistic and transport system that are behind that service. But today, the transport possibilities are restricted in many ways. Due to poorly utilized transport infrastructure, restraints on mobility has a negative impact on industries and increase emissions, noise, accident risk, and social cost. I would say that most transport systems today are efficient in theory. But in reality, many are not utilized to their full potentials. So what kind of innovations can increase transport efficiency today? One area where the Volvo Group see a great potential for progress is within the ICT area, the information and communication technology. I truly believe that ICT can have a very positive impact on mobility and pave road towards transport and resource efficiency. Let me give you two examples of future mobility solutions that involve ICT. Plateauing, where you actually electronically connect a number of vehicles after each other and thereby having the leading vehicles to drive the other vehicles. That is one example of an innovation that really and heavily rely on strongly state-of-the-art ICT applications involving the drivers, of course, but also the vehicles, infrastructure, and very much the traffic management system around in the world. It is actually now being demonstrated under real circumstances, and a new legislative framework is needed to enable them to be introduced in public on a large scale. The Volvo Group is right now performing demonstration of the plateauing technique with trucks in combination with cars. And together with the company with the same brand as ours, the Volvo Cars, we will perform these demonstrations in the streets of Gothenburg coming. The second example is that we cooperate with a number of players, including the City of Gothenburg, the Swedish Energy Authorities, and a cluster of science companies. We have introduced a public transport system initiative for the full electrification of city buses named Electric City. It will go into operation as a fully commercial bus route in 2015, and an important part of that initiative is to use a set of new ICT applications that focus on aspects including services for the travelers, safety, and again, traffic management. Ladies and gentlemen, these two examples would have never been possible without a very strong cooperation and commitment from politicians and authorities. It is important to bear in mind that the two cases are interesting as they actually challenge the present standards of transportation, but also the present standard of legislation. They could not have been carried out without a clear business case. Volvo initiated both of these projects, and we are prepared to take steps forward in collaboration with authorities around the world. And in these two cases, we are actually looking at a game-changing development. And if we examine what's already out on the roads in terms of the intelligence that we put into our vehicles, both on the car side, on the truck side, we have an enormous amount of ICT capabilities already. But if we then look at the infrastructure that those intelligent cars are actually running on, and we compare that a decade ago, There are a number of things that have happened, but it's mainly not much of intelligence in the infrastructure today. That means that almost all the intelligence is in the vehicles, and the lack of ICT solutions in the infrastructure means, in my opinion, that we're not utilizing or fully utilizing the potential for the existing traffic systems, and we do not utilize the full potential for ICT solutions. As one of the world's largest manufacturers of commercial vehicles, our investment in ICT, we believe, is money well spent. It certainly contributes to our competitiveness, but the industry needs consistency in policies and stability to be able to invest and develop sustainable transport solutions. For a global manufacturer like us, global harmonization is very important, and here we need political leadership. We also need much stronger support from authorities and society as new paradigm shifts, concepts are introduced, because those concepts are costly. They are costly to introduce, and therefore society must be prepared for introducing them, for instance, within the framework of infrastructure and connectivity standard. It is not until we get the new technology in large-scale demonstration projects that we can prove to the public that it is a game-changer, that there are benefits, and it's benefit for the society as a whole. As I mentioned in my introduction, ICT solutions can be and should be the catalyst for environmental, economic, and social sustainability around the world. In this area, we have everything to gain from a much closer cooperation between policymakers and industry. And I believe it's vital if we are to address the severe challenges that the world of transportation is facing, that we work closer together and that we try to utilize the efficiency and making sure that we get the efficiency of the transport systems that it deserves. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Mr. Persson, for that fascinating presentation. And I invite, as I said earlier, I invite ministers to indicate if they would like to make comments or pose questions so that we can come to you. Mr. Persson, could I ask you, in respect of your remarks, you've talked about the need for consistency and for continuity in talking to public policy makers and leaders in this field. How, in developing your conversation with a group of ministers from so many different countries here today, would you propose moving up the gear from the kind of demonstration effect and cooperation you have in Gothenburg to that wider scale? What is it, in a more focused way, are you asking people? And let me tweak the question a little bit. Getting legislation right includes getting it not too early and not too late, not too fixed in a rolling technological environment, so also flexible. So what are you inviting the policymakers here to aim at in terms of where you're aiming to bring Volvo?
I think your point is extremely important and very relevant. My point and my view is that legislation has to develop in line with the demonstration of the new technology. That means that we, step one is to make sure that we allow and also cooperate on large-scale demonstration projects, thereby gaining experience, thereby also gaining experience of actually conducting and constructing a legal framework that is suited for that new technology. We should remember that one of the, if you look at autonomous car driving, is based on the Vienna article from 1954, regulating the vehicles and the driver's responsibility and also the responsibility for the animals. And I think it's, when you look at the new technology, we need also to look at what that brings in. But you're absolutely right. The second one, which I would like to emphasize very much, is of course the fact that we need to discuss standards. The application that is built on with ICT gives us a huge amount of flexibility, customization, adaptations to the different cities, to the different countries. But there must be and there should be a certain base of standards that we all can use. And the world has shown before that it's absolutely possible to come up with those standards.
Sorry, that is not a card. I was looking at the back there and a bit distracted. Let me ask you on the standards debate again when we come to it. And a lot of people refer back in time to of a certain generation to when videos came in and whether it was VHS or not and who got the call right. You're talking also in this, one part is standards, one part is about what you called intelligent infrastructure. And the infrastructure piece in general is more public than private in terms of cost implications and budgets. Could you give some examples, again, from the way you're working from the ground up in Gothenburg, what kinds of things are you asking people to invest in terms of hardware, software combinations that render an infrastructure in a city more intelligent than today's infrastructure would be?
I think one area of infrastructure intelligence is, of course, monitoring in a more direct and sort of on-time matter, meaning that you actually can plan. And then again, I mentioned in my speak many times the traffic management system. I truly believe that if you look at the congestions and the situations in many of the cities, it is a infrastructure issue, yes, but it's also a traffic management issue. And thereby, the ICT can help very much in predicting, steering, making sure that the flow of the traffic in the cities are being better. So it is all these kind of different technologies of actually monitoring and steering technology, which could be beneficial for actually increasing the flow into the cities and also create flexibility.
Could I invite UNICEF, please, to pose a question?
Well, thank you very much. Actually, it's not a question, but because it was raised that the Vienna Convention has this famous article about the driver must be in control of its vehicle all the time. Actually, in March, the representatives of the governments agreed on modification of this article. This modification pegs the Vienna Convention and conventions and the 1949 conventions with the vehicle regulation agreements of 1958 and 1998. The modification is expected to come into force if there is no objection against these modifications actually in the coming 1 year. So there is already some progress about some of the modifications.
Thank you. I don't see at the moment any ministers offering. Can I just say we also have a general roundup at the end so we can keep questions there. Could I thank you, Mr. Persson, and move, if I could, to our next guest, Mr. Brian Mistela, who is CEO of INRIX, because I think there is a very nice segue. Mr. Persson has just finished with a request, really, about if we're going to get smarter, to start monitoring, collecting a lot more data, predicting a lot more. And in fact, INRIX, the company of Brian Mistela, is probably, in global terms, the biggest developer, supplier of metadata, the kind of massive amounts of traffic data that we need to begin to read, to predict, and to develop new management systems. So, Brian, over to you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, ministers, and ladies and gentlemen, for inviting us to attend. There's been a lot of talk at this conference and other conferences about new ways of collecting traffic information, about getting data from vehicles themselves as they're out on the road. Talk about crowdsourcing data, people reporting accidents and congestion and things like that. I want to start by asking you to imagine a new world. Imagine a world where you had more than 100 million vehicles and devices out on the road today that could tell you what traffic is like, covering more than 4 million miles of road that you're able to look at in real time to determine traffic patterns. Imagine further this were in more than 40 different countries around the world today, and that information could be used by traffic operation centers to optimize traffic flow in and out of their networks. Imagine it could be used in planning purposes to optimize traffic signal timing, that information could be broadcast into a large number, millions of vehicles and devices, and that people could make better decisions based upon that data. And imagine that freight companies could optimize their deliveries and their scheduling based upon not only real-time information, but predictive information, knowing what traffic will look like not just an hour from now, but a day from now or a week from now. What a world that would be. What an impact you could have on one of society's biggest problems, which is traffic congestion. That world is not in the future. That world exists today. Most of you may not be familiar with NRICS, but we are the leading provider of traffic information today in more than 40 countries. We aggregate data from consumer vehicles. We aggregate data from commercial vehicles. We aggregate data from cellular carriers and cell tower messages, as well as hundreds of other data sources to get a global view of what's happening with traffic information. Most of you probably see our data every day and have no idea where that data comes from. But if you buy a late model BMW, Audi, Toyota, Ford Motor Company vehicle, Nissan, Lexus, and a variety of others, the information that you see in the head unit of that display is coming from NRICS. But more importantly, you're part of that network, anonymously providing data back to help people in front of you know what traffic is going to look like based upon what people in front of them saw. If you use a mobile device, you use a Garmin mobile device or a major mobile application, chances are that you're part of that global network providing traffic data. NRICS today provides data to more than 250 different customers that use that data in their products and services. This is truly a global network of companies helping each other to really identify what's happening with traffic information on the roadways. And it's being used today not only in the private sector, but by literally hundreds of public sector agencies using to optimize their overall traffic networks. So what can you do with that data? This is very hard to see on these screens. This came from National Geographic, who actually took our data and looked at the top 100 cities in terms of traffic congestion on a global basis and actually wrote a report. We provide information to free of charge as part of our annual traffic scorecard, and we rank traffic across the entire world. The interesting thing is if you have global traffic information, and it's consistent format, and it's collected in a consistent way, you can actually start to compare cities. You can start to compare countries. You can start to make real data-driven decisions based upon investments and make real trade-offs around mass transit versus expanded capacity versus redesigned lanes versus traffic signal timing and understand the cost-benefit of those type of investments. What you see from this graphic is, in some degrees, counterintuitive. The number one city in terms of traffic congestion in the world is not New York, it's not Sao Paulo, it's not Moscow, it turns out to be Brussels. If you measure by overall travel time, the impact that it has on the average driver's life, Brussels comes out number one. If you look at, down the list, smaller cities like Stuttgart turns out to be number five. Of course, Moscow, Sao Paulo, Beijing are on the list. Turns out, in the top 10, the United States only has one city on the top 10, which of course is New York. Many people are familiar, of course, with traffic, but you can actually now start to quantify it. In the European Union, more than $20 billion is lost in terms of the cost of traffic congestion. This is a real cost in terms of wasted fuel and in terms of lost economic activity. Globally, in the top 100 cities combined, almost $100 billion cost of traffic congestion in the top 100 cities. If you look at fuel, more than 8 billion liters of fuel is wasted due to traffic congestion. This truly is a global problem. If you want to look at it in terms of people's lives, 25 billion hours lost in terms of people's lives stuck in traffic congestion. The worst city, Brussels, almost 2 weeks for the average commuter is lost time spent in traffic congestion. In the top 100, the average person spends more than a week stuck in traffic congestion on a global basis. Phenomenal impact. If you look at trending, it's even more interesting. For the last 3 years, what you've seen is a decrease in traffic congestion globally. And that's because traffic congestion is tied to the global economy. But what you've seen just in the past 12 months is an increase of almost 6% in terms of traffic congestion in the top 100 cities. In fact, if you look at the top 100 cities, this is the first time in more than 4 years that we've seen the majority of cities increase in terms of the overall economic impact and the overall congestion in those cities. If you want to quantify it, obviously GDP and the growth of an economy is tied to traffic congestion. And it turns out, on average, there's about a 3x multiplier. Meaning, if your GDP increases by 2%, you can expect, on average, your traffic congestion in that city to increase by 9%, or 3x that, 6%. So there's a 3x multiplier, on average, for traffic congestion. Of course, it works the other way in reverse. And in an economy, in a downturn, if there's a 3% decrease in GDP, there'll be about a 9% decrease in overall congestion. So what do you do with all this data? We've talked about potential solutions to traffic congestion. We firmly believe that data empowers people, that the democratization of this type of information can have a huge impact on traffic congestion. I was at a conference and Al Gore came up to me. This was a green tech conference in London about 9 months ago. And he said, you know, there's many companies that are trying to have a positive impact on carbon emissions in the environment. Enrix is one of those companies that is truly having a real quantifiable impact. And that's because if you can reduce traffic congestion, you can reduce not only pollution and carbon emissions, but obviously have a really positive impact on the economic activity in most major cities. In fact, studies have shown that if you can by giving people access to traffic data, whether it's in their car, on their mobile device, on signs that go across the road, you can decrease traffic congestion by more than 10% in the average city if you can have a good penetration of people who can have access to that information. And that's our mission as a company. Our mission is simply to reduce traffic congestion globally by giving people better information, but also by giving governments better information. Let me give you a few examples of that. Again, I know these slides are very difficult to see, but I'll give you a couple examples. On the East Coast of the United States, more than 15 states have gotten together and created the I-95 Corridor Coalition. They wanted a comprehensive view up and down the East Coast of how freight moved and how people moved. It's not good enough just to know what traffic is like in New Hampshire or Rhode Island. You needed to know how it moved across the entire corridor. What we've done is we've been able to provide that information that they're using in their traffic operation centers for real-time incident response for emergency management. When Hurricane Sandy hit the East Coast of the United States, they were able to deploy real-time emergency response vehicles based on what they really saw happening in real time with the traffic congestion in and out of those cities. In the United Kingdom, the entire country of England outsourced their traffic collection, and we're working very closely with the Highways Agency, which is using it for planning purposes as well as real-time traffic management, managing the traffic in and out of not only the London corridor, but across the entire United Kingdom. This isn't a proof of concept, this isn't a trial, this is live today. The vast majority of traffic information, whether it's in the BBC, Sky News, radio, TV, across the roads, mobile apps, in the country of England is being generated real time, not based on government-funded sensors, but based on private vehicles, mobile phones, and aggregating all this data. And then one final example is BMW. You may have seen the BMW iSeries vehicle on display here. That has multimodal information to allow someone, when they get in their car, to not just see what the quickest route is from point A to point B, avoiding congestion, but to see if it's actually quicker to take the train or a bus, or to take and drive to a park and ride and then take the bus the rest of the way into the city. Again, this isn't a hypothetical. This is shipping today in BMW electric vehicles powered by Enrix, this multimodal data. So by giving people real-time data, giving governments better data, we firmly believe that you can have a real impact on one of society's biggest problems. People will make better decisions, governments will make better decisions, and ultimately you'll have a better outcome. Thank you for your attention.
Brian, thank you very much for that presentation and for some of the insights that the data has provided, but for the wider insight of the concept that you've talked about. You used a phrase which I found very interesting. You talked about the democratization of data. And in effect, you're talking about a system which can atomize the information because handhelds or smart cars or whatever can connect. Talk to me about the relationship between that atomized process, democratization, and the idea that we were talking about earlier about the role of setting standards and legislating. Where do these things come together and converge, or do they diverge in terms of what the offer should be, what the question should be?
Yeah, that's a great question. So again, you know, we collect data. I mean, this is a big data and analytics problem. More than 30 billion data points come into our operation centers, our more than 4 data centers scattered around the world, and process more than a petabyte of information in real time. This is truly one of, you know, the world's biggest big data problems in terms of collecting this data and analyzing it. But to your question, the interesting thing about this system is it's happened with absolutely $0 of government funding. It's happened entirely in the private sector, and it's been because, quite frankly, customers have demanded it. Customers want to know when they get in their vehicle or when they're on their mobile phone or when they're on a website what traffic information is like. Companies like BMW and Audi and Toyota and Volkswagen, they want to provide these services to their vehicles. So the system has been created, again, in the private sector for the benefit of everybody, benefit of public sector, private sector, based entirely on market need. And we think that's really the greatest path to innovation. There hasn't been any standards that have been needed to create to enable this type of system. Now, there are privacy issues, and the way that our customers have gotten around that is it's all anonymous. We're not tracking any individual person or any individual car. All of this data is collected anonymously, again, for the purposes of aggregating it and providing a benefit to society. So the easy answer to your question is there really aren't specific government standards that are needed to enable or help accelerate this type of investment. The market's demanding it, people are demanding it, customers are demanding it, which is why it's been created.
Thank you. Without asking you to break confidentiality, I think one of the things you mentioned also is that the United Kingdom, which is clearly one of your clients, had outsourced, you said, the traffic data collection. Could I just ask you, whenever all that data goes back in, because you have this metadata, you mine it, you categorize it, you offer it back to the client in some usable form, are there practical ways, again relating to the first presentation we had, of how that is being converted by public authorities into user-friendly outcomes because of getting smarter and getting quicker?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, that's obviously the benefit to the United Kingdom and why they did this, is they wanted a consistent view of traffic information that they can provide on websites, they could provide it on reader boards along the side of the road, on 511 e-call type services, and provide it as obviously part of their emergency management and public management. One of the more interesting applications in terms of the United Kingdom is as part of the Olympics and as part of Queen Victoria's celebration, they actually took the cellular data that we were able to collect from cell towers, not for traffic purposes, but for managing population density. They didn't know where the population movements would arise during the London Olympics, how many people would go to each venue. So they used population data and population movement to better respond through mass transit, through public sources in terms of being able to move incidents around, as well as putting more police in certain areas to manage crowd control. So this is one of the big benefits of this type of data, is there's a whole bunch of applications that governments are starting to identify for both real-time planning as well as predictive purposes.
Thank you very much. Let me turn, please, to the Minister from Morocco.
Thank you very much. Merci bien. Je tiens à remercier le CEO d'Enrix. Effectivement.
I want to thank the CEO of Enrix for his presentation, and particularly for the content of his presentation, where he provided important elements to us. Now, listening to him, you come to the conclusion that there is a close link between growth, i.e. GDP growth, and traffic congestion. These two items are correlated. Now, could you just say instead of investing into industrial activities, we should rather focus on agricultural production. But probably this is not the ultimate solution to address traffic congestion. But would it not rather be wiser to first start investing into infrastructure? What about the links that you have explained for a couple of cities? Is it really possible for you to show, because there's always a gap between theory and practice, as everybody knows, there is some difference there, and by way of some cities you took some examples of cities, and there are a lot of other cities worldwide that we don't have data from, and not all cities suffer from congestion. How can it be guaranteed, if we take a city like Brussels, how can it be guaranteed that decisions that were taken there have a really positive impact on growth, on economic activities, and what do you do with the endogenous and endogenous factors, variable factors? And can these results that you have presented be used for other countries too? That is, also be applied to countries which are still in a phase of development. What are the very basics and fundamentals? How can I, as a political leader, assume that I can follow your approach? Thank you.
I think that's a very good... You know, what we do, I think, for the first time, has been able to look at traffic information globally and correlate that with factors. And what we have seen, of course, is there is a direct positive correlation between GDP and economic activity and traffic congestion. In fact, traffic congestion is a leading economic indicator. We actually have, for instance, hedge funds that buy our data to predict economic activity for different countries and different regions. To answer your question, though, of course, each country is somewhat different. I mean, traffic inherently represents people driving to work, companies making deliveries, freight movement between different areas, so there is real economic activity. It's not our goal as a company to prescribe particular solutions. It's our goal to provide data and help governments make real data-driven decisions based upon that information, and then to provide analysis on, you know, benefits of different approaches. You know, so we can't, for instance, you know, tell a particular country the best thing for you to do is to build a particular roadway or expand your ramps or move to mass transit. Ultimately, those are policy decisions, and we're not a policy company. But what we can do is provide information to show, for instance, the impact of a light rail system. I'm from the city of Seattle, and we spent $3 billion building a light rail system between the center of our city and our airport. It turns out that had almost no impact whatsoever on traffic congestion on the roadway. Now, there may be other reasons to have done that project, but if it was to solve traffic congestion, it had no impact. Likewise, we've seen other approaches, congestion-based pricing, HOV lanes, and a variety of other approaches. Traffic signal timing. Los Angeles retimed more than 10,000 traffic signals using our base traffic information, and that had a real quantifiable impact on traffic. So again, our goal is to provide data and help governments make more data-driven decisions so that they'll know ahead of time what the impact will be, and more importantly, after they make an investment, they can actually check to see if the benefits actually met up to the expectations of the project costs that they incurred.
Thank you very much, Brian. I think we might move on to the next presentation. And again, you're staying with us, and we can come back with some wrap-up questions at the end. I will invite now Mr. Lutz Bertling, CEO of Bombardier Transportation, to take the podium and to address us. Just closing out on what you had to say, Brian, it's interesting in your Seattle example, spend $3 billion on a light rail system but make no difference to traffic congestion. I listened to a presentation yesterday from Copenhagen that the link mass transit between the city and the airport is now bringing 60% of passenger movements on that link. So there may be cultural differences in some places where the car is king and in other places where it's not. But we can come back to that at another stage. So Lutz, you're very welcome. We look forward to your remarks. And again, I invite any colleagues who wish to pose questions, please, to indicate as suggested earlier. Thank you.
Yes, dear Mr. Chairman, dear Mr. Cuvillier, dear ministers, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, thanks to give me the opportunity to share some thoughts with you this morning about Bombardier and Bombardier's contribution and the industry's, the rail industry's contribution to these transportation problems. I've deleted one part out of my speech, and this is the one about information technology, because it has been tackled twice already, so I will just repeat. Let me first give you a short overview about what Bombardier is. We are the world's only manufacturer of trains and planes, and actually we should be at that page. While Bombardier Aerospace, the number three in the world market for planes, offers a broad portfolio of innovative business and commercial aircraft, Bombardier Transportation, which I am heading, is the global market leader for rail transportation systems. Over the years, Bombardier has developed the broadest portfolio of winning mobility solutions in rail transportation. And everywhere people travel by land and in the air, a Bombardier product is ready to transport them. At this very moment, more than 100,000 Bombardier trains and locomotives are being operated worldwide. And our motto is the climate is right for trains. And I would like to give you a few examples for this in the next minutes. Today, I want to focus on the particular challenges that come along with the global megatrend for urbanization. The way innovations in transport can offer solutions to address these challenges, and what you, the policymakers, what you can do to make it all happen. You all know urbanization is one of the key challenges to transport today. 50% of the global population lives in cities today. 70% are expected to do so by 2050. You know these figures, and all these cities are facing the challenge of getting more and more people into town in the morning and out of it in the evening. And if you look at the UN report on world urbanization from 2011, it says that the 10 fastest growing mega cities in this world will grow by more than 40% between 2011 and 2025. And this 40% are representing more than 70 million additional people living in just 10 cities on this globe. Now, a region where this particular trend is taking place at the highest speed is South America, where it's expected that 80% of the population will live in urban areas by 2025. The city of Sao Paulo approached us a few years ago to discuss the plan to build a metro from the airport to the city center, but the cost of a 24-kilometer long tunnel, plus the duration of the construction, plus the impact of this construction on the road from the airport to the city, just made the plan nearly impossible. Now, together with transport planners, we took a step back and said, let's not look at one single product to solve this transportation problem. Let's look at the problem first and open our mind for possible solutions. And together, we identified a transport solution that has been at hand and proven in service for many years, the monorail. Monorails can transform urban transportation from airport links to dense inner city routes. They move hundreds of thousands of passengers safely, efficiently, and comfortably day after day, same as a metro. But the major advantage is, compared with a metro, a monorail system costs considerably less, and you can save years with the implementation. So today, Bombardier Transportation is delivering its game-changing monorail system for this new Sao Paulo Metro Line 15. Fast and cost-effective to build, this new monorail system will provide mass transit capacities for Sao Paulo citizens. The journey currently takes almost 2 hours by car. The new monorail system, this will be reduced to approximately 50 minutes to the benefit of 500,000 users daily. And when fully equipped, this monorail system will be capable to transport 48,000 passengers per direction and per hour. This example just demonstrates how driverless monorails meet the demands of growing cities and combine several advantages. Now, what's the message behind it? How can you, policymakers, help make it happen? Very simple, and this is just an example, very simple. If you ask for a metro, what you will get is a metro. But there's more. If you tell us your transportation challenge, We will provide you with the optimal solution to address that challenge. And this might not necessarily be the system which you have in mind. And we will incorporate your key requirements like infrastructure constraints, layout, design, budget, passenger flow, and many more. We are able to do this because we have the largest portfolio in the industry, and we supply everything from electric buses to very high-speed train, which means that we have the best solution for you, but please don't specify the solution, specify the problem, and talk with us about the best solution. My second topic is about what we call Echo 4. As a global market leader for rail systems, we have of course considered how to strengthen our, let's say, bread and butter business with innovations in keeping up with current trends. It goes without saying that this includes how to make our trains more environmental friendly, more energy efficient, and more cost effective. For the past 8 years, we have been investing all these self-funded money for research exclusively in systems which we group under the heading Echo 4. Developed in close collaboration with rail operators, our Echo 4 technologies are, we call it, the most efficient way to save the planet. They are built on four cornerstones: energy, efficiency, ecology, and economy. That's Echo 4. Incorporated into our products right from the design phase, these technologies ensure maximum energy efficiency from start to finish. And by implementing these solutions, operators can generate an overall energy saving of up to 50% compared to previous vehicle generations. They also reduce emissions, cost, noise, wear and tear, and travel time. These economical, sustainable solutions ensure cost-effective mobility and a minimal environmental impact. Our Echo 4 solutions range from lighter weight, lower maintenance bogies with reduced wheel and track wear, to intelligent, comfort-driven interior climate control, and from optimized aerodynamic performance of very high-speed trains to catenary-free tram operation in cities. Now, once again, my question: how can you, policymakers, how can you help to make it happen? If you only ask and tender for acquisition price, you will get none of these solutions. But ask for life cycle cost, ask for total cost of ownership instead of that, and we will be there to offer you latest Echo 4 technology. And these solutions, which we will offer at economic terms, will pay back after a very short time. We have recent order intakes where we have been 7, 8, 12% higher in acquisition price. And the calculation of the customer is that this 12% can be regained within 3 years' time, but he will operate the system for 30 years. My third and last point is about what we call Prime Move. We have not only developed technologies for a rail system, but also other ways to make global transport better for the environment and more energy efficient. One example is a technology for energy transmission via induction. You all know this from your electric toothbrush. It's cableless, it's induction. And this technology we have already developed, tested, and approved for trams, and we called it PrimeMove. We have now further developed these technologies for use in buses, so we can help towns take the next step and electrify their buses without having to face the usual difficulties of batteries that weigh tons or overhead lines, for example. Less than 300 kilometers from here, the PrimeMove bus system has just entered its successful passenger service in the city of Braunschweig, here in Germany, with the German capital Berlin and other cities in Europe and North America soon to follow. Our groundbreaking PrimeMove e-mobility solution offers diverse ways of wireless charging all types of electric rail and road vehicles. This includes trams, buses, cars, and trucks. Based on inductive power transfer, as I said, like in your toothbrush, PrimeMove eliminates the constraints of cables, wires, and plugs, making urban transport more flexible and convenient than ever before. Our PrimeMove solution empowers cities to address through CO2, address tough CO2 emission targets and cope with growing urban mobility-related challenges. And this sustainable commuting solution is the key to quieter, cleaner, and more attractive cities. Imagine a city where all vehicles are electric. You don't get rid of congestion, but you get rid of pollution. So quiet and emission-free. Imagine cities where mass transit vehicles blend seamlessly into the landscape, no catenaries or wires, leaving the cities, its landmarks, or heritage sites intact. Imagine electric vehicles that don't need to be plugged in to recharge and don't negatively impact your driving habits or traveling time. This is the power of our game-changing PrimeMove e-mobility solution. Again, how can you help make it happen? Push for electrification in your cities and be reassured solutions exist. I've just given you three examples. The industry, and I'm not only talking for Bombardier, the industry is there to provide you with the best solution for your transportation problems. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much also for that very interesting presentation. One point I would like to return to with you, which was a pretty big public policy point in the middle of all of that, was the question about tendering for public projects. And you've made the point that typically or very often when you deal with a public authority, whether it's municipal, regional, national, that the issue of the bottom line price is the driver to do with the tendering logic. And you're saying, in fact, if you look at the life cycle cost, there's much better value for money to be got by looking for a different bottom line. Talk a little bit about that, because traditional systems typically have more relied on tendering based on initial acquisition price than life cycle cost. And do you meet pushback or resistance where people say, well, you would say it, wouldn't you? Because, you know, you've got something that's very efficient, but the upfront cost may be that bit dearer.
Yeah, from my point of view, there's three steps. The first one is you just look for acquisition price. And you put out a spec, and whoever meets the spec is fine, is qualified, and then the lowest bidder wins. You might lose lots of direct impacts, which brings me to step two. If you just look at life cycle cost, you take into account energy consumption, you take into account maintenance costs, you take into account how many trains you need to serve a certain need because of reliability of the train. You might, with a higher reliable one, you might need two or three trains less for your need than with the other one. That's the second step. The third step is, if you really take into account the real cost of transportation, the real cost of transportation takes into account the space you need in your city. It takes into account that you need to compensate people for changing windows if the train just runs in front of their building because it's so noisy, so go to the more silent one. This brings me to the total cost of ownership approach, where you not only look on the direct saving you get out of a more energy efficient train or more reliable or less maintenance demanding train, but then you go to the one which is causing less vibration to the track, which is causing less noise and so on. So there's a third step beyond, which is total cost of ownership, where I believe if you go with that calculation, you can really come to a totally different approach. I believe as well that in particular in mega cities, you need to think about what the real price is and to which extent you are ready to subsidize rail transportation. This is, by the way, the biggest provider worldwide for e-mobility. This is metros and EMUs and commuters and so on. But the real price should include what you need to deal with the congestion of the road system which you have. And then you come to a different equation.
Let me ask you also, if I could, to take one of your phrases in the opening part of your remark. You said the climate is right for trains. And it gets into the policy zone of if the climate is right for trains, for all the reasons you've described, the Eco4 system that you described. How do you believe public authorities should prepare users, consumers, for the necessary modal shift? because the climate may be right to do with mitigation issues, CO2, save the planet, and all of these drivers. It may be right to do with cost and bottom line in ways you've just described, total cost of ownership, but you've then habits of a lifetime. And what advice would you give? Where have you seen good examples of clients creating modal shift by the soft policy? They invest in the hardware, but to optimize it, they need the accompanying measures.
I would raise 3 points. The first one is get in contact with my predecessor, with the previous speaker. Provide the right information technology. Provide real-time information to the passenger. Make sure that the passenger, when he plans his trip, and planning his trip is actually even the decision in the morning, do I take my car or the bus or the metro? Make sure that he takes an educated decision by knowing precisely how long it would take for him, based on real-time data, to get to the target of his journey. Number two, provide capacity. Capacity in infrastructure, capacity in trains. People hesitate to take trains if they are always overcrowded, and they hesitate to take a train if they don't need which train they will reach because the station is overcrowded, they simply can't get to the train. And look at Sao Paulo, for example, it's a good example where you sometimes have tens of thousands of people in metro stations. So reliability, and for that you need to provide capacity in the train itself, but as well in the infrastructure providing the train. And the third one is get prices right. Take into account when you decide on the price level you want to have for rail transportation, take into account the real cost of the alternatives, the real cost of the congestion of your city by individual car traffic.
Thank you very much. What I will ask you to perhaps resume your spot, and we'll get on with our conversation. Thank you very much for that presentation, and we'll come back presently. Thank you very much indeed. Now, I understand we have a number of interventions that have been signaled and foreseen, and one of those is from the Chinese delegation. And I would like to invite you now, please, to make your remarks. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President, distinguished ministers, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to the ITF Secretariat for the intelligent efforts paid for the successful convening of the annual summit. My special gratitude also goes to the President of France and the host country of Germany for holding the summit. And also on behalf of the Ministry of Transport of China, I would like to extend my thanks to the French Ministry and the German Ministry for your diligent efforts for this holding of this convention. And the theme of this summit is about transport in a changing world. Hereby, I would like to brief on innovation for changing transport. As this is really my great privilege to attend this summit to conduct in-depth discussion with you. Since 2013, China has stepped in the historic stage of deepening reform in an all-round way. China is confronted with a series of outstanding problems such as ecological and environmental degradation, exhaustion of natural resources, urban transport congestion in accompaniment of rapid urbanization and motorization, aggregating air pollution. All the above-mentioned problems have raised higher demand for China's transformation of development a mode and an innovation. Consequently, as an important engine of social and economic development, China's transport sector is faced on the pressure for further transformation and upgrading. It seems that scientific innovation is the only way that promotes transformation and upgrading of the transport sector. In recent years, China has achieved tremendous achievements in building its modern transport infrastructure network, represented by expressway and highways, rail. Moreover, China has possessed modern transport equipment, incorporating new energy vehicles, mega container vessels, liquid vessels, and high-speed trains, modern transport management and service system, incorporating intelligent transport system, integrating mobility and the freight multimodal transport. We see that the rapid momentum of development in the above-mentioned areas. To a certain extent, transport development has satisfied the increasing needs of the Chinese people. We would like to seek all opportunities to promote green recycling and the low-carbon integration of transport system, promote the application of energy conserving and environmentally friendly equipment, a hydro power, alternative fuel, electric urban public buses, and a new power-driven vessels. Organize and undertake the pilot projects of national smart transport with international things. Conduct project integrating informational resources of the Yangtze River, launch the Big Dipper, seaborne search and rescue information systematic project, expressway optic fiber network project. So we have seen this improvement in the above mentioned fields. In additionally, key scientific research and the construction technology suspension bridge has made technological breakthroughs. For example, the key technology in the offshore deepwater port construction has won the prize in the national wide. In recent years, China has identified the development objectives, that is, the integrated, smart, green, and safe transport as the current and future development goal. One core work is to deepen the implementation of innovation-driven development strategy, accelerating scientific innovation capacity, and promote transport transformation and upgrading. In more specific terms, we need to identify and intensify scientific innovation by means of promoting integrated transport system, enhancing transport infrastructure modernity, building low carbon transport system, promoting modern logistics, and improving safety emergency response capacity. It is necessary to carry out a series of important informational projects. In more specific terms, we need to build a coordinated management and informational service system concerning integrated passenger transport hubs, establish multimodal port container transformation service system, build national and local logistic public information service platform, establish urban smart public transport system, and launch relevant informational pilot projects. Only in this way can we accelerate the transformation of scientific achievements into transport productivity. Ladies and gentlemen, as the symbol of human civilization, transport sector never ceases to innovate. As a newly emerging economy with rapid pace advancement, China anticipates to avail itself of the ASEAN platform of the International Transport Forum so as to strengthen cooperation, drawn upon advance experiences from other countries, accelerate innovation, and promote the transformation development transport sector. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I think this is an important insight because we have talked so much about urbanization and its impact. And of course, many of the great mega cities of today and tomorrow are in China. And so to hear about these developments and innovations is especially interesting. And thank you for that contribution. Let me invite, please, from the floor, a contribution from the Russian minister.
Ladies and gentlemen, Chairman, I should also like to thank you for the excellent organization and the excellent preparation of the documents that were submitted and passed to date, the declaration and other papers. We have worked very effectively so far, and I followed with great interest the presentations that were held in the course of today. The speakers were excellent. It was very interesting and exciting to listen to them, and I wrote down a lot of interesting comments. Particularly was interesting to learn about modern methods of the transportation system, the monorail system. We also have got a highly developed public transportation network. We've got more than 7,000 kilometers of tram lines and electric bus lines. And this mode of transportation needs to become more attractive for passengers. And in this view, it is very important to inform passengers. So that is what the presenter from the United States alluded to. We need to provide information, and I listened very carefully. 10%, we could save up to or reduce congestion by up to 10% on the basis of good information only. We transport a large number of people through public transportation, and that is why the public transportation system needs to become more convenient and more environmentally friendly. Russia is the geographic bridge between Asia, the Pacific region, China, and Europe. And under the conditions of a changing world, the haulage operations try to optimize their own logistics chains. Let me briefly report about the Northeast route, the Northeast Passage, which is the shortest maritime route between Europe and Asia. It is the route from Shanghai to Hamburg over the Northeast Passage. It's 6,400 kilometers shorter than the traditional route, which leads through the Suez Canal and the Malacca Strait, and this passage allows you to save 30 days of travel time. And if you just consider that a ship consumes up to 60 tons of fuel, that means that you could save $600,000 to $700,000 if you just take the shorter route. There are financial savings possible and time savings possible. The passage would take up to between 7 and 20 days. And it's very important to provide a fleet of icebreakers to keep that passage clear. In 2013, this route was traveled and used by 619 vessels. Alongside the entire route, we have installed a global satellite network called GLONASS. The stations are in the Arctic area for this GLONASS network. And in the framework of the development of the GLONASS project in December 2013, we have started another system, which is the first one worldwide. It is an emergency system for shipwrecks. We called it AeroGLONASS. AeroGLONASS, this system, this emergency system, is already operating not only in Russia, but also in the other countries of the customs union, Belarus and Kazakhstan. These countries developed very similar systems following the example of the Russian one. The system ERA GLONASS is very important. It is compatible to the system which is currently being developed in Europe, ECALL, E112, that's the name of the system. And this compatibility, the possibility to exchange data, was proven. There were a number of pilot projects and field tests out there that were carried out, and work is currently underway so that the Russian system, ERA GLONASS, would be merged with the other emerging system, COSPAR-SOSAT. We believe that this is also something that can increase efficiency and safety significantly. The safety of the transport sector would generally be increased as a result of these projects. I want to thank the organizers again. I want to thank the ministers from France, particularly from France. I want to thank the Secretary General for the excellent work to organize this summit and for the hospitality they have shown to us. Thank you very much.
Спасибо. As I look around, I don't see any other offers to intervene. Et donc, Monsieur le Président, je pense que mon travail a terminé et la parole reste à vous, Monsieur le Président. Excusez-moi, le Maroc voudrait mes excuses, Monsieur le Ministre.
Yes, I also want to say something.
Merci encore une fois, Monsieur le Président. À mon tour, je me joins donc aux intervenants précédents pour féliciter donc les responsables du forum et pour toute l'organisation, mais aussi les sujets traités. Je profite de l'occasion, puisque effectivement ce forum est un forum de réflexion, mais aussi d'échange, pour poser trois questions qui me semblent être importantes pour un.
There is no interpretation possible for the time being.
Ministre et aux décideurs qui sont là.
We have heard about the innovations. We heard about them during the presentation of Volvo. We heard about the databases managed and provided for by INRIX. We heard the presentation of Bombardier, who follow a series of new approaches in the field of transport. They talked about monorails and other approaches. Now, from my position as a politician, if I have to take a decision, it is a decision which will be taken to the benefit of our citizens. Now, if I'm sitting in front of a citizen, would this citizen really try to find out whether the mode of transport he wants to use would be propelled by electricity, whether it is in keeping with the Eco4 requirements or not? Or would it be rather a consumer, or would it be a mode of transport which doesn't consume much fuel? Are these the questions the citizens would be driven by? Or would he rather look for other issues concerning mobility? That is, he would look for whether the mode of transport he chooses would be punctual and convenient to use. So for me, it is very important to have arguments ready at hand when talking to citizens. This is also true for those companies who drive innovation. They need to give us arguments that we can use in our talks to the end user of a means of transportation, so that the consumer understands that it's to the benefit of the society and to their own benefit when we introduce such a mode of transport. As a policy maker in the field of transport, we are in a paradoxical situation very often. This paradoxon consists of us having different modes of transport: air transport, maritime transport, rail transport, road transport, and these modes compete to each other. Should you build more railways, build less roads, and so on and so forth? And in view of this competition of the individual modes of transport, you have to ask yourself how they can rather complement each other. What we need is a kind of balance, an optimal situation which allows us to be competitive and to drive down costs, at the same time being able to provide for the right modes of transport, and at the same time making sure that this situation of a competition ends up not in a situation where things are incompatible with each other, but where they rather complement each other. Third point, funding. In the International Transport Forum, we have individual meetings that focus on funding, and there we look at the investment for transport. What kind of added value would be generated for the state, for the society? There are multipliers, follow-up effects as a result of which an investment into a mode of transport bears fruit in other areas. Now, how can we make sure that even when you work in PPP projects, how can you make sure there that public money would be used wisely for the society, for the community? How can we guarantee that aspect of development has already been catered for in any kind of project plan, so that an investor ultimately would also have a bottom line that he can live with, so that he has a return from the investments they have carried out. And investments into a transport sector would at the same time also be an investment to the society and to the well-being of society. I think these are the three points that should be raised, albeit not necessarily solved in this forum. They should be raised at least. And I want to thank you for the excellent preparation, for the excellent presentations that we were listened to, that we were able to listen to, and for the exchange of views that we have already been able to have. Thank you very much. Minister, maybe I led you too early to the end of the debate, and I would like to ask the Secretary General to give a brief response. You have pointed out a number of questions to be discussed, which will make us think long and hard. Secretary General, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chair. I volunteered to give this choice because the questions were so complex that, if you allow me, changing my jacket from Secretary General to that of my previous job as Professor of Transport Policy and address these issues. They very much are compatible. This very much is aligned with the work that we've done here in the ITF. On the first question, it is very clear to researchers in this area that there is not a single individual preference. Different people make different choices. So one of the important things for policymakers is that we should be providing a range of choices to the population. Whenever you try to provide a single option, too many people will feel left out. But it's not just about providing the choices. It's about including in the choices the economic and the regulatory signals that will stimulate the people to choose options in such a way that the aggregation of the individual optima is close to what you consider to be the social optimum. This is a combinatorial trick. It's not easy to do, but it's at least this should be the aim in designing those incentives that will lead the choices of the citizens. If you put this in this framework of the need to provide multiple choices, the second question becomes much clearer, much easier to answer. The question about is it complementarity or competition? It is both. They are competing in the sense that some people will choose A and some people will choose B. Maybe even the same person in some days will choose A and in other days will choose B because the daily agenda is different. But they are complementary, because some people will choose to start their trip with A and finish with B. Or even the same person, as I said, could use A in some days and B in other days, but he wants to have a common transport title that allows him to use one and the other. So it's complementarity in space, complementarity in time, and integration in tariff and information. On the third one, which is related to the economic impacts of transport investments, the solution in principle is not very difficult to speak out. It's a little more difficult to apply in practice, which is basically when you're analyzing the project, you have to consider not only what our friend from Bombardier said, to go from the acquisition price to the life cycle costs and then to the cost of ownership, but to evaluate the whole of the social impact of the project, not only in the balance sheet of the authority, but also considering the economic impacts of the project in the rest of the economy, and namely what in the jargon of the profession we call the indirect and the catalytic effects. If you are able to bring all of this, and there are methods for doing that, with some uncertainty remaining, I agree, but at least it's worth giving it a good try and not giving up from doing it just because it seems a little complicated. If you do it like this, at least you have a reasonably good perspective of where the choices could be going. I hope it was not too confusing.
Secretary General, thank you very much for that intervention. Let me, on behalf of everyone here, thank our three speakers, Olive Persson, Brian Mistele, and Lutz Bertling, for the wonderful contributions that they made here today. Et donc, je suis arrivé finalement, monsieur.
And last but not least, I would like to pass the floor to our president. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Secretary General. Thank you very much, Pat. And thanks to everyone in this room and to our three speakers and to the delegations, the Chinese, the Russian, and the Moroccan delegation for their contributions, which enriched our exchange. Questions are often very complex and a lot is at stake. Of course, we were not able to cover the entire subject because many of our participants contribute to the complexity of this topic, but that doesn't have to be a disadvantage. Public authorities have to make decisions. That is often difficult because there are many interested parties involved in developing a solution. For example, the industry, science and research, all these actors contribute to finding solutions for the world of tomorrow. Many initiatives have been launched which should contribute to finding compatible solutions. And not solutions which are not able to be implemented internationally. Then, of course, we focus on innovation, on cooperation between public and private sector. And it is essential that we continue this dialogue because it opens new perspectives also on the cost factors. The impact of investments on economy as a whole is a topic that we could continue speaking about for a long time here. But perhaps we need something else apart from intellectual input. Therefore, we should interrupt our work and go to lunch. But before we do that, I would like to ask you to stay in the room briefly, because we will now take the traditional family picture. First and foremost, I would like to thank all participants, the delegations. It was a very successful roundtable. Thank you to Pat Cox. Thanks to everyone, and see you later.